Hi everyone, hope you're all having a great day today. In today's video, I'm going to cover BlackBerry stock because I'm going to cover Q4 earnings that's coming up in March of 2024. They're going to be announcing the Q4 earnings plus forward outlook for the next fiscal year to come up, so the next 12 months. This video is going to be jam-packed. It's going to be actually quite long. I'm going to have year-over-year comparison, quarter-over-quarter comparison, forecast, what is expected, how the stock could essentially perform in the next 12 months. I'm going to cover the auto sector in terms of Ford and GM, in terms of what can we expect moving forward, because a lot of business for BlackBerry moving forward in terms of anticipation is predominantly tied to the auto sector. I'm going to play a clip from Ford's CFO, an interview with CNBC. I'm going to cover the Federal Reserve's interest rate in terms of will there be cuts or not be cuts, just because that does affect consumers' borrowing power, which in tail affects their purchasing power basically overall. I'm going to cover the stock in terms of how much it's shorted, also insider transactions in terms of sales and buys, pre-forewarning, I guess. It's a lot of sales. There's no buys from what I saw. I'm going to go over it right now again, just in case anything updated. And again, I'm going to cover the stock performance. So sit back, relax, basically. At the same time, if you do find this video beneficial, consider dropping a like and subscribing so you'll be notified the next time I do upload, and does help the channel. So thank you so much for that. And again, sorry for the delay for this video. It was supposed to come out past few days. It took longer than expected in terms of gathering the information, but it is quite beneficial, this video, I think, overall, because again, this does highlight, in my opinion, the performance expected for the next 12 months for this stock. First things first, in terms of the stock overall, we already have the outlook for the next Q earnings. They mentioned it in the last earnings in Q3. So Q3 was announced, let me just move here for a sec, was announced on December 20, 2023. And they had an outlook, which was the reason why the stock went down, because this earnings was actually really good, right? We had year-over-year beat, quarter-over-quarter beat, a bunch of everything, amazing stuff, right? The downfall was, the reason why the stock went down was the outlook for the next earnings was like, just FYI, it's going to be low. And it's a mix of low and bad kind of thing. So the total company revenue for Q4 expected, which will be reported on March of 2024, ending the quarter February 29 of 2024, is about 150 to 159 million, right? So total company revenue is 150 to 159, which unfortunately, which I already pulled up last year, so I can just pull it up again. If you want to look up past performance, all that stuff, go to BlackBerry Investor Relations website and you could pull up past performances, past financial reports. They have up until 2021. You could pull up press releases and so on and so forth. So if we pull up last year's Q4 of fiscal 2023, they had 151 million last year, same quarter of Q4. The problem about the 150 to 159 million that they're projecting, it's essentially showing like flatline growth, right? For the most part. So no real year-over-year growth for that quarter. And then also the worst part is, if we pull up the quarter prior that we had in December that I mentioned, actually I was already on it anyway, we had 175 million. So it's going to be quarter-over-quarter decline, year-over-year flatline. So not really much of growth right there. That's the problem, right? And in terms of IoT revenue, IoT revenue is doing great. It's, the problem is what's getting hit. If you're asking what's the issue here, it's predominantly cybersecurity, actually. So IoT revenue, the Q4 expected to come out, it's around 62 to 66 million. Last quarter, it was 55 million. So we have quarter over quarter growth. And I believe it was year over year growth as well. So this is March 30th last year, same quarter. And we had 53 million. So year over year growth, quarter over quarter growth for IoT, which is great. Again, IoT encompasses QNX and BlackBerry Ivy. BlackBerry Ivy revenue is still in the early phases. We're not seeing anything crazy yet. We'll see, hopefully, later on. Which, again, the reason I'm excited to show you the CFO's chief financial officer of Ford interview with CNBC, he states basically the power growth of revenue that's going to be coming in their second phase of their vehicles, right? And it'll make more sense, but it's really exciting stuff. Basically saying that we haven't seen, hypothetically, almost in a way, nothing yet in terms of revenue, because the connected services and all that stuff is to come in the second phase. And you'll see in the video, it's awesome. But again, that takes time, just FYI. And one thing I want to state, like always, I'm not a financial advisor, not a professional or anything. So please do your own due diligence and research before buying and selling. And at the same time, I do own shares in BlackBerry stock. So bear that in mind while you're watching this video, obviously. So there's that too. So in terms of cybersecurity, so let's go back to the cybersecurity and the outlook and all stuff. The outlook is 83 to 88 million for cybersecurity revenue. And if we look at last quarter, it was 114 million. So we have quarter over quarter decline. If, by the way, these are just estimates, they could surpass them. The only problem is I'm not expecting it just because this guidance came out pretty close to the Q4 earnings. So they just released it during Q3. They could surpass it, but it's not really likely the case. I'm going to show the street estimates as well too, to compare what the street estimates are expectations, which is beneficial too, by the way, because from what I saw, they are on the low end, but I'll show that soon too. And if we look at last year's cybersecurity, it's 88 million. So from their forecast, it's pretty much flatline slash slight decline too at the same time, which is unfortunate. And then licensing and other revenue, it's 5 million, but it's negligent. It's not really a big deal, but it's 6 million last quarter. So quarter over quarter decline, but don't worry about that stuff. That's just small minuscule stuff anyway at the end of the day, and 10 million. So year over year decline, quarter over quarter decline. Now in terms of the street estimates, just so that you're aware, financials, analysis right about here. If you want to pull them up yourself, if you ever want to check them out, just go to Yahoo Finance and just click on analysis and all stuff, and they'll pull up earnings estimates and revenue estimates from the street, right? So they're expecting for this quarter average estimates of 3 cents per share loss, and then I'll show you what actually they got last year. So they got 2 cents loss per share. So they're actually expecting worse performance than last year, so we could essentially beat the street estimates for that point. And then revenue estimates, they're expecting about 153 to 154 million average for this revenue for the quarter, which is surprising because BlackBerry gave to 150 to 159 million from what I remember. Yeah, 150 to 159 million. So they're expecting on mid slash low range, and even in the high estimates, they're expecting 154 million. So none of them are giving 159 million that BlackBerry basically gave that range for. So the good thing is though, the stock won't really get an impact based off the revenue itself for the quarter, just because what we're expecting on the low end, or what the street's expecting is the low end. And at the same time, we already know what's gonna happen. What will hit the stock a lot and will, in my opinion, predominantly outline the next 12 months in terms of performance for the stock outside of company news that comes out from as a surprise is the outlook for the next 12 months. So when they report their Q4 earnings, they tend to give an outlook for the next 12 months for the fiscal year, right? So for the next fiscal year, they're gonna say our company revenue is expecting to make this much for the following year coming up. And as you could see right about here, last year, they reported total company revenue came in for the fiscal year was 656 million, right? And then this fiscal year, what they're gonna report, it depends. So I calculated it, and based off the estimate that they gave, it's going to be somewhere between 590 million to 600 million, which is a year-over-year decline, which is unfortunate for this fiscal year that just basically is wrapping up. But the thing is, though, they're going to report close to 800 million, low 800 million. It was like 820 million or something. I can't remember. If you count, actually, I'll show it right about here. If you count the patent sale. Because if you remember from their Q1 of this fiscal year, they had the patent sale go through, and they had a massive chunk of 235 million come in, which not inflates, but it is true representation of the company revenue for the year. So if you count that, then this fiscal year that they got was about 800 and something million in the low end of revenue, which if you count that, then basically you have year-over-year growth, because last year they reported 656 million of year-over-year growth and all that stuff. But if you don't count it, it's year-over-year decline. So it depends if you want to count or not count it. Now, the reason why I'm saying that the fiscal year is very important in terms of how the stock will perform for the next 12 months outside of company news that will be coming in as a surprise is because if they're expecting to have, for example, somewhere in the ballpark of like $700 million or $600 million, the stock will pretty much be flatline for the most part until some major news comes in for pretty much the next 12 months in essence, because it shows in essence almost no growth slash flatline, right? Especially if they report lower than 600 million, then it's going to be horrendous. But if they state $800 million, it's going to be great. But what I'm hoping for is somehow if they mention that they're going to get 900 million or 880 million or 1 billion in revenue for the fiscal year to come up. Now that is a big stretch to ask for. But if they do mention that, for example, if they mention about 900 million, I believe that represents 12% growth year over year, if you count the patent sale in terms of the patent amount that I mentioned earlier. And then if you don't mention the patent amount, it represents about almost 50% year over year growth. And if they do 1 billion in terms of revenue for next year, that represents about 25% year over year growth in terms of company revenue growth. And that's if you count the patent sale, the amount that came in last year. And then if you don't count it, it represents about 67% year over year growth, if I'm not mistaken. So that would make the stock jump quite significantly. The stock would react favorably towards that outlook that they represent, and the stock would jump. Now the question is how much and all stuff. It depends. It depends on how well the news is received and all stuff. I did look at the stock in terms of technical analysis. I remember I had a number, but I have to go through that again. Sorry, I should have done that before this video. But at the same time, the stock will act favorably towards that outlook, and we'll see growth, in my opinion, continue within the 12 months until more news comes in and all stuff, et cetera, et cetera. But I think the stock will behave favorably, basically, right? Now, again, if it's flatlined, we're basically going to be in the same ballpark unless news comes in later on with, for example, new design wins. They got a contract with another OEM in terms of BlackBerry IVY, so on and so forth. That will move the stock up higher. But in the meantime, if that outlook is just flatlined and those news don't come out, it's just going to be, the stock's going to continue flatline, if not, maybe even decline. But I want to cover one thing though too. In the meantime, before Q4 comes out, right? I've shown this before, technical analysis. It's just general sense, high level. It's nothing crazy. What I want to state that is how low will it go, in my opinion, before the earnings, unless if some horrendous news comes out, which hopefully doesn't happen. I'm basing it off of 2001. We saw a clean drop right here around $2.50 mark, and a clean drop right about here. Not clean, but pretty much bounce off of $2.27 mark. So essentially, the lowest we'll go is the low $2 price point. I don't think we're going to break that. There is a chance, in my opinion, I think we might be bouncing back up soon, to be honest. I don't think we're going to see those low levels. But again, nothing is guaranteed. Literally, bad news could come out of nowhere, and we could go lower, right? So again, please do your own due diligence and research before buying and selling. But we've pretty much hovered around these price points. Quick drops in 2001, quick drops, not quick drop, but 2001 as well. And then back in 2020, March of 2020, we dropped around the $2.70 mark. So in my opinion, until Q4 comes out, I don't think we'll be breaking that $2 price point. In case if people were worried about breaking that $2 price point, just FYI, that's the reason why I'm mentioning it. I'm gonna cover the auto sector next, and then I'm gonna come back and cover the, not the street expectations, but additional analysis, holders, short positions, and so on and so forth. But again, those are the outlooks I'm looking for. Now, in terms of the auto industry, GM reported best quarter, I guess, best year since 2019 pre-pandemic. And there's a good amount of stuff to show by here. Ford's actually even better, in my opinion, in terms of showing potential growth, plus a CFO interview, which is amazing. But I just want to go over GM. So for the year, GM managed to hold onto its US sales crown, selling 2.6 million vehicles for the year, up 14% from 2022, and its best year since 2019, when it sold 2.9 million vehicles before the pandemic and global chip shortage. The reason why this is significant, in my opinion, is because if you see in terms of sales, they're pretty close to 2019, like around the same ballpark, right? 2.6 million versus 2.9 million pre-pandemic and all stuff. But at the same time, if you notice, vehicle prices have gone up, right? So they're more expensive, yet they're pretty close in terms of pre-pandemic and chip shortage. And then at the same time, the incentives were not as high, right? So if you look at 2019, the incentives per vehicle were ranging somewhere between $5,000 to almost $8,000 incentive wise. Now they're ranging between $2,000 to $3,000, give or take. So the incentives are lower, vehicle prices are even higher. And then at the same time, I want to mention one other thing. So you can see vehicle prices are higher. But the reason why I'm mentioning all this, incentives are lower, prices are higher, plus interest rates are higher, right? If we look at federal interest rates, the chart right here, it shows in 2022, let me see. So 2019, basically, we were at 2.39%. Then we dropped down to like one, basically almost essentially zero all the way through. But then in February of 2022, it looks like we were just about to start growing. And then we just jumped up right now at 5.3%. And if you wanna look at all of 2023, so start of 2023, we're basically at 4.33%, right? And then towards the end, we're basically hitting 5%, right? If we actually pass 5%, 5.33. The reason why this is significant is because it lowers the consumer's buying power. If it lowers the consumer's buying power because it increases the monthly payments, then auto sales essentially like could get hit, right? Because the buying power gets reduced. They can't essentially buy as much as they would want to. But we've seen in terms of GM, that's not really the case fully. People are still buying nonetheless, even with incentives lowered, right? The reason why I'm mentioning this is because, again, BlackBerry IoT, or BlackBerry in general, is the future, in my opinion. The major growth is essentially tied to the auto vehicle, auto sales, right? The more sales we have, the more partnerships we have in terms of for QNX and BlackBerry Ivy, the more growth we'll see, because my money is more on the IoT side of the business. Cybersecurity is nice. They should essentially, honestly, grow it way more. This is not really impressive. This is major letdown in my opinion. They could easily grow this way faster. We've seen competitors grow it faster, but one thing that they're ahead of, in my opinion, there's no real competition, is in terms of BlackBerry Ivy, which falls on the IoT revenue side. So that's why I'm more fascinated on the auto sector in terms of growth. So now in terms of Ford, they report in terms of this earnings that just came out a few days ago, Ford reports 7.1% increase in US new vehicle sales as industry marks best year since 2019. So that's great. So again, given that incentives are lower, I'm not sure if essentially Ford gave lower incentives, but I know prices have gone up higher. Federal Reserve interest rate has gone up higher. Again, buying power hasn't been lowered, but they're still seeing sales going up, which is amazing. Ford Motor reported sales of nearly 2 million vehicles in 2023, a 7.1% increase from the year previous year, but its sales increase is lower than the overall industry growth. So again, it's lower, but yeah, it's still growing. So other automakers are growing as well. So that's all great stuff. So I just want to show in terms of numbers wise. So the next thing I want to show is the interview, which in my opinion is great.
One that's not showing red at all though is Ford. Those shares are jumping after beating on the top and bottom lines. And joining us now, Ford CFO John Lawler and our very own Phil LeBeau. Phil.
John Lawler, thanks for joining us. We talked about Ford beating the street on the top and the bottom line in the fourth quarter, but I want to talk about your guidance for this year. Strong guidance, $10 to $12 billion adjusted EBIT expectation, free cash flow expected to be $6 to $7 billion. You know what the sentiment was out amongst the average investors, that the legacy automakers would struggle with these new UAW contracts and that business, while it would continue, would not be as strong as we've seen over the last couple of years. What's your outlook when you look at the year?
I think you're seeing the broader picture of Ford, the strength we have. We have an incredible commercial business, which was up 20% this year. We expect it to grow again in 2024. Our ICE business, Ford Blue, is doing very well. It grew the last 2 years. Profits were up. And, you know, we at Ford have an incredible position because we can offer our consumers choice across all powertrains, ICE, HEVs, and electric vehicles. So we cover the broad spectrum of what consumers want. You know,
and one thing I want to mention here. So they're expecting more growth, which is awesome, right? So that's just beneficial because I want to show that the auto sector is not essentially dying and is growing. And then also they cover multitude of different types of vehicles, ICE, all that stuff, EVs, hybrids. That is important for the next statement that he's going to mention later on at a 2:44 mark. I'm going to come back to that just because I want to remind people BlackBerry Ivy just doesn't cover just EV vehicles, by the way. So yeah.
You know, last year, our EV sales were close to 300,000 units, up 20%. So, you know, we're really in a good position to take advantage of the marketplace.
Let's talk about your EV expectations, because you're cutting down your full pure electric vehicle production outside of Detroit, at your plant outside of Detroit, cutting it down starting April 1st as the market, the growth there has just not been as strong as many expected it to be. Do you think that's going to change even more once we get into the second quarter and the third quarter?
Well, we're adjusting based on where the consumer's at. What we're finding is that you move past the early adopters into the early majority. They're just accepting the vehicles at a slower pace. And that's why the flexibility we have and the choice we have is key. But it's not the same around the country, Phil. When you look at the West Coast, Washington, California, Oregon, EV mix is 30% of our F-Series sales. EV and HEV mix is 50% of our sales. So the adoption is going to be different around the country at different paces. And with our flexibility, we can meet the consumer where they're at.
So I do want to mention one thing. Again, so BlackBerry IVY, the benefit of it is it's not solely just EV. It's connectivity for all vehicles that are basically, you could almost treat it like, for example, when we transition to smartphones, right? As long as the vehicle hypothetically becomes a smart vehicle, it does not matter if it's combustion or EV or hybrid. BlackBerry IVY will apply to any vehicle that wants to be a smart vehicle based on the OEM automaker, whatever they set that platform to be, right? So that's the benefit of BlackBerry IVY, and he's going to touch base on it soon. And in terms of sales, by the way, I'm going to mention the Federal Reserve as well in terms of interest rate, in case you're interested in terms of will they lower interest rates, will that bump up auto sales? So I'm going to touch base on that after this video.
John, thanks for being here with us on Overtime. Toyota, your competitor, said today it's going to invest $1.3 billion at its Kentucky facility focused on electrification. How are you thinking about the amount of electric investment you're going to continue to make from here, even as demand, as you just mentioned, continues to be regional and less than some had expected?
Well, we're going to adjust as appropriate based on the demand. But make no mistake, EVs are coming and EVs are part of the future. So we like where we're at. We've been out with our first generation of vehicles for a couple years now. We've learned a ton. We're working on our second generation of vehicles. We're putting in a good footprint, although it's smaller than what we had planned, appropriately so, given the demand. You know, we're in a good position, especially with the fact that we're moving into our second generation vehicles in the near future where they'll be profitable, and we expect that they'll be game changers because it's not just the EV technology, but it's the connected technology and the software and services that will come with those vehicles.
John, it's...
Did you guys hear that? So first of all, he said near future, second gen, right? And basically, essentially what he's saying, in my opinion, again, this is my opinion, please do your own due diligence and research before buying and selling. So it'll still take some time, by the way, but he says near future, and we don't know necessarily how near that means, but essentially saying the revenue predominantly, in my opinion, from what he's saying, is going to be coming mainly from the connected services, right? And we know BlackBerry has worked with Ford in the past, and I don't think there's really a competitor with BlackBerry IVY. We've heard from before, from the previous CEO, John Chen, state that some OEMs, I don't think Ford is essentially one of them, but some OEMs are trying to do it themselves, and they're basically finding out, or if not, they will find out that they can't do it themselves, and they might as well just go with BlackBerry because it's an easier transition, it's more smoother transition, and BlackBerry IVY is way ahead than anybody else. If you do remember, if you've been following BlackBerry for quite some time, I have. BlackBerry, it's the only company that I'm aware of that essentially has been invested this much in terms of a smart city. Now, you might have your own opinion based off if you prefer smart city or not. I'm not necessarily a fan of smart city, but in terms of any other company, I haven't seen any company work with making a smart city happen, hypothetically. I know they've worked with the Canadian government, had a small portion of land, and demonstrated a smart city in general, which is all part of connectivity, right? So BlackBerry is ahead from what I know from others, and they might be biased, obviously, because it's their own company, but BlackBerry states that there's no real competition for BlackBerry IVY in general, right? I'm not just talking about, like, for example, CarPlay or Android Auto. Those are just simple things, right? Those are just for the infotainment system in general. They could go more in depth, obviously, but at the same time, we know that BlackBerry is on the background of these operating systems as well. We know that Google uses BlackBerry. We know that because it's back in the backside of QNX and all that stuff, right? The backbone is partial QNX use. So just FYI.
Hey, John, one last question. Pricing, as you look at 2024, everybody expects it to cool off just a little bit from some of the record levels we saw last year. What's your expectation in terms of when someone goes into a dealership, what type of pricing changes might we see over, let's say, the next 6 months?
Yeah, so that's really important for us. What we're seeing is that prices will probably come down from planning purposes. We're saying 2 to 3%. The most important thing is affordability. We think affordability in 2024 is going to go back to pre-pandemic levels, and that is percent of disposable income to buy a vehicle per month. We think that's going to revert back to the pre-pandemic levels. So affordability is going to improve this year.
All right, so that was interesting in towards the end, because they're saying that they're going to essentially drop prices a little bit more, which is awesome. And at the same time, from GM's standpoint, I don't know about Ford, but incentives for vehicles are increasing in terms of like $1,000 off, $2,000 off, and so on and so forth. So if we're seeing prices drop potentially, plus incentives increasing, not a guarantee Ford's doing the same path, but that's great, because quick thing, in terms of Federal Reserve, are they going to lower interest rates? Because if they lower interest rates, that increases consumers' buying power. Therefore, they can buy the more expensive vehicles. But if they're reducing prices too, at the same time with interest rates lowering, that is a great combination. Unfortunately, it's a bit of neutral ground. So if you see Jerome Powell's latest 60 Minutes that was covered a couple of days ago, in essence, in summary, Powell believes that it's unlikely that the committee will vote to cut rates coming this March. The following committee meeting ends May 1st. Almost everyone involved in the committee meetings believes it will be appropriate to cut the Federal Reserve funds rate this year, Powell said. So this year, rates will be cut. He's just afraid that he doesn't want to cut them too soon, but he's saying we can't not cut them at one point. So I'll just continue the quote. Cuts, when they come, will probably be small. So they will be small, not massive, likely a quarter or maybe half a percentage point at this time, assuming inflation data remains good. Inflation data at one point was 9%. And then it currently is roughly about 3%, just FYI. They're trying to get to 2%, but he stated in the interview, we don't necessarily need to be at 2% to cut rates. But yeah, so we just want to see some more good data along those lines. It doesn't need to be better than what we have been seeing, or even as good. It just needs to be good, Powell said. So in my opinion, what this means is no matter what, rates towards the end of the year will most likely be cut, again, quarter to half a percentage point. So that'll bring us just under a 5% interest rate. Now, what does that mean to me? I don't think necessarily this will change that much in terms of auto sales. In terms of buying power, it doesn't mean that much. If it was a full basis point, a full percentage point, that would be massive. But again, every little bit helps. So with this potential drop a little bit, but again, this is going to be probably closer to towards the end of the year. So we might not even see real effects in this fiscal year until maybe next fiscal year, just FYI. So that's the thing. But with Ford and like maybe GM's doing the same thing, lowering prices for the vehicles, plus interest rates dropping, sales could go up. Again, the reason why I'm focusing on auto sales is because BlackBerry, in terms of the IoT portion of the business, is growing. And if auto sales slow down, I would assume that sector, from everything it entails and is collaborated with, would take a hit as well. And I don't want to see that happen in terms of forecasts and all that stuff, right? So there's that. Now, in terms of how much the company is shorted, the reason why I want to cover that, or we could cover the, no, I'll cover the insider right after this, but I just want to cover how much they're shorted, just because sometimes people do mention it and they are, they're curious about it, right? And there is a benefit to it. So if it was highly shorted, if the company was highly shorted, the benefit of being highly shorted, well, it's a pro and con actually. The con is, unfortunately, the stock would be taking a beating constantly, because if it's constantly being shorted, what that means is, hedge funds or whoever might decide to short, it doesn't have to be just hedge funds, right? But it tends to be hedge funds, is they'll borrow shares. It might be your shares, whatever, from an institution bank holder that holds these shares, borrow these shares, sell them at the current price, right? And essentially borrowing the shares, but sell them at current price in hopes that the stock will go lower, and then they'll buy back the shares and then return those shares back to whoever had them originally, and then profit the difference. That's the benefit of shorting for the short people who are shorting, right? The unfortunate part is this does bring the stock down, because the way it brings it down is because if they're selling it and pocketing the difference right now, the sale volumes and all stuff, especially within BlackBerry, is such a low volume, it doesn't take much to bring down the stock. It'll just bring down the stock because they're selling shares, right? If there's not enough buyers and there's only sellers, then the supply and demand share price goes down. Now the benefit of it being overly shorted, right? If it's extremely shorted, to be considered extremely shorted, it has to be 20% or higher, which I'll show the percentage soon. But if it's extremely shorted, It's here's the pro, but it's difficult though, is if it's extremely shorted and the stock starts going up based off either earnings in terms of expectations, surpasses expectations, outlooks, some major news, whatever it might be, if it's jumping significantly higher quite rapidly, quite quickly, then what happens is these banks that had the shares tell the hedge funds or whoever's shorting, FYI, the stock has been jumping dramatically. The amount of sufficient funds you have in your account is not going to cover the share price at a certain point. So just to mitigate risk, we're requiring you to buy a certain amount of shares, or if not all of them, depending on how many funds they have, to buy back the shares now, because we need the shares back now, because we don't think that you'll be able to return it in a future date, because depending on the risk and so on and so forth. Now, the benefit of that is if they're buying the share back price, shares back, right? And the share stock has been gone up higher. And by the way, it's usually higher than what they borrowed it for too, right? Depending on how many funds they have available on their account. So the news spikes it up, or outlook or earnings, whatever spikes it up. And now these shorts are buying the shares back. They're driving up the share price as well, because again, supply and demand. So if there's more buyers than sellers, the share price is gonna skyrocket. But the thing is though, it's like a domino effect, right? Back when GameStop and all that stuff happened. Now GameStop was shorted over 100%. That was significant. AMC, I don't think was ever shorted 100% at all. I think it was only like around 20% or something. But again, that was considered extremely shorted, right? That's the benefit of it. Sets a domino effect where one hedge fund that's shorting buys in because they're triggered by the bank institution that they borrowed from stating that you need to buy it. They buy shares, bring up the share price. Another hedge fund, their trigger amount might be higher because they have more sufficient funds on the side, but the price is going up still. They're forced to buy by their bank holders, institution, whoever has the shares they borrowed from, so on and so forth. And just a straight domino effect, right? And then it hits the news, et cetera, et cetera. People get excited, FOMO, so on and so forth, et cetera, et cetera. The reason why I'm saying that is because, unfortunately, we're not at that level, right? Well, actually, it's, again, pros and cons, right? If we're extremely shorted, that's a downfall. Again, these are self-reported, by the way. I should mention that. These are self-reported numbers, so it could be shorted way more. There's like dark pools and all that stuff. I'm not into that personally too much, because I can't track it. I just don't know how to track it personally. I know some people who are very savvy in this stuff and they're able to track it, but I don't have real proof, so I can't share that information. That's the only problem, right? But in terms of self-reported numbers, if you go to Yahoo Finance, type in BlackBerry, this is on the US side, right? Again, the stock ticker symbol information I shared earlier with a $2 price point, that was in US traded shares, so it wasn't the Canadian side, just FYI. But so US currency. So in terms of self-reported, it's shorted about 7% on the US side, right? And then if you go to the Canadian side, it is shorted about 1.something%, right about here. Oh, wow. Okay, so went up, actually. So this got updated, it looks like. So on the Canadian side, it's BB.TO for the ticker symbol. US side is just BB. And it went up to almost 3%. So the stock is shorted about 10%, right? Now, is it shorted a decent amount? Definitely. I would say 10% is definitely on the high end, but is not considered extremely shorted. That's all it is, right? So we're shorted about 10% of the stock, which is quite a bit, actually. But again, not extremely shorted. So it won't necessarily trigger the massive domino effect. Again, this is the self-reported numbers, though. That's the thing, right? So now I'm going to show the insider selling, because the reason why I'm mentioning it is it could look quite significant. Again, this is just my opinion. Please do your own due diligence and research before buying and selling. And again, I do own shares in BlackBerry stock, so keep that in mind while you're watching this video. But the reason I'm covering this is we've seen multiple times, it looks like John DiMatteo, CEO of BlackBerry, Ray Steve, CFO, Dickman, Officer Erickson, so on and so forth. They're selling shares, right? So what's going on? It's not a good sign when you see insiders selling shares. But the reason I'm covering this is because essentially, in my opinion, they're selling these shares to cover the tax portion of the awarded shares, because they're not selling shares that they previously owned just the sake of selling without being awarded shares. They're getting awarded shares a few days prior, and a few days they're selling a portion of those shares. And in my opinion, those portions are small enough to cover the taxes, and probably some expenses that they have on the side potentially. They're not selling all their awarded shares. The reason why I have my cell phone pulled up on the side as well is because, unfortunately, Yahoo Finance is not really showing the table on the right side. I can't zoom to the right or something. I don't know what's going on in terms of scrolling, but it'll show you the past transactions. So I can pull up on my phone right about here on the Yahoo app, though, but not endorsing Yahoo app or anything. But It's just I could pull it up here. So on January 5th, John G. Matteo was awarded about 71,000 shares, right? And on January 5th, I believe the same day, no, January 8th, so 3 days after, he sells about 18,000 shares, a little over 18,000 shares. So again, it's not majority, it's not half the shares, it's just a portion. And in my opinion, given it's the end of the year, it's tax season, right? I'm assuming this is just covering taxes and maybe additional expenses that he might have on the side. In terms of Ray, CFO, he was awarded about 35,000 shares. And on January 8th, he sold, if this is correct, 20,000 shares. So that is quite a bit. Again, that could be taxes slash with the expenses. But again, it's not all of them. These are awarded shares. There's not just like he's selling shares that are not awarded. Then we got Dickman. He was awarded about 15,000 shares. And he sold on 3 days after. So all of them, same thing, January 8th. He sold about almost 6,000 shares, right? So again, not all of them, assuming they're just covering taxes and some expenses. Again, this is pretty much tax season. And then Erickson sold got awarded about almost 38,000 shares on January 5th. And on January 8th, he sold about almost 14,000 shares, right? So once again, and then we had in December too. So we had some January, a bunch of awarded and sales. So John G. Matteo was also awarded about 106,000 shares January 3rd, right about here. 106,000 shares, and he sold almost 30,000 shares. Again, the reason why you might be asking, okay, what's with all these sales though? Why don't just sell once? Is because each award, like it's almost like when you get your paycheck, right? Every paycheck you're getting taxed on it. It depends if you're working for somebody or your own business, right? But if you're working for somebody, they pre-tax it right off the bat in the check itself, right? Depending if you opt for it or not. And so every single time you get paid, you're getting taxed on it. So that way you're just getting the portion that you're paid out. So essentially they could be going for the same option where they're like, okay, if I'm awarded this much, I want to sell this much right off the bat for tax purposes, right? And there's that. But basically I already looked through all of them and just awarded sales. I might have missed one where it was probably sales, but I doubt it because I already checked all of them, but I could be wrong. But all of them were awarded. I don't think a single one was sale without awarded. Just to cover what's going on here. Because again, it's not good to see insider selling, but at the same time, just FYI, that's my opinion, reason why for the inside selling. If they were selling all the whole entire lot, then obviously there's something going on besides just taxes. It could be for some purchases, but if they were doing, for example, we saw a bunch of January, December, and all stuff, if all of them were 100%, I don't know what kind of expense they got that they need to sell everything, in my opinion. Right. But in terms of this earnings, I'm expecting a flatline. What we're looking for mainly is for the outlook. And that will dictate, in my opinion, the next 12 months, besides obviously news that would be coming out in terms of BlackBerry, Ivy, partnerships, contracts that are signing. But I'm expecting big things for BlackBerry Ivy, in my opinion, but it's gonna take some time. For example, we got the Foxconn deal. That's not gonna print money until probably 2026, because Foxconn is expecting to really run stuff in 2025. So we won't really see, maybe we'll see in 2025, but it's gonna take some time. That's a problem. It's not like it's gonna be just tomorrow. So that's the thing. But good promise from Ford, it looks like, because essentially that he explained BlackBerry Ivy, in my opinion. And they've worked in the past with each other, BlackBerry and Ford. It's a good future. It's just the problem is being patient, which is unfortunate because it's like BlackBerry investors have been patient for quite some time. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Hope you guys liked it. Hope I didn't miss anything. If you have any questions, comment down below and I'll answer them as soon as possible. Sorry for the delay. It took longer than expected for this video. I try to gather as much information as I can. And if I missed anything, I'll post another video or I'll comment down below if I could comment it quickly. And that's basically it. Thanks again for watching. I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.